Now we start with different types of tanks on gas carriers. So generally we have very simple integrated tanks on chemical and oil tankers, that is integrated gravity tanks. But we have very different tanks on gas carriers because of carried in either highly pressurized or semi-pressurized or fully refrigerated tanks, which have high stresses on the tanks. So simply, if you see in your home, you are having a refrigerator. So because it's doing a very high freezer, very low temperatures. So because of that, it needs a lot of insulation. And like you are putting, you need ice. So ice you are keeping in an independent tray, which is not attached to the freezer. So that is called independent tank on the gas carrier, which is not attached to the hull. And like you have a LPG gas cylinder. So this gas cylinder you see is made of very thick metal because, and it is cylindrical in shape. So these two cylindrical shape and a lot of thickness of metal is required for carrying gases in liquid. So these are called pressure tanks. So let's see the type of tanks. Pressure tanks can be integrated because they are not causing the hull temperature fractures, metal fractures. So, but other refrigerated ships or semi-refrigerated ships need to have a independent tank. So semi-refrigerated can also have membrane tanks, or mostly LNG ships also we are using membrane tanks. So let's see what are these tanks. So we have four types of tanks. IMO has divided these tanks into four main types: integrated or independent. Independent is again divided into type A, B, C as per the pressure and requirement and alloy it's made up of. And then we have membrane and semi-membrane tanks. That's what we will see. So integrated, as we know, is attached to the hull, and independent is independent of the hull. So the main characteristics of your integrated membrane and semi-membrane tank is that they all transfer cargo from, they all transfer the static stresses in the form of tank pressure to the hull because it is connected to the hull. So integrated can be membrane and semi-membrane, and independent can be membrane and semi-membrane also. So in integrated, all the stresses are transferred to the hull, but in independent, there's no connection, so no stresses are transferred to the hull. Then next thing is what are integrated tanks? The first cargo compartment system, which we have in oil tankers or OBO carriers or chemical tankers, is your integrated tanks. Normal tank which is connected to the hull. This type of is suitable, generally suitable for gas transportation. As we have seen, we need either cooler cargo or what you call pressurized cargo or semi-pressurized. Then we have membrane tanks. Membrane tanks are divided into two groups, membrane tank and semi-membrane tanks. Membrane tank is has equal membranes, two equal membranes outside, and is built up with two equal membranes, and semi-membrane has only membrane against the cargo, single membrane or the metal as a secondary barrier. So semi-membrane system has a membrane against the cargo and the metal or veneer as a secondary barrier. So there's only one membrane and secondary barrier is a metal. It is common for all membrane tank that there is no center bulkhead. So membrane tank generally they will not have a center bulkhead to reduce the free surface effect, and is built up with a trunk for narrowing the tanks up against the top of the tank. So you have a trunk which is going up on the top. We'll see in the figure. Also, membrane tanks, they are made up of, membrane means it's a very thin layer of inverse steel. So a very thin layer of inverse steel or stainless steel or nickel steel. It's 36% nickel. So what are the characteristics? Because it is very thin, so thermal expansion, like your ice cube tray is very thin. So thermal expansion takes place very easily, and there is not too much of fractures or something. And the metal is chosen in such a way that it becomes so hard that it cannot crack also. So with the thin layer also, the material is so strong, like inverse steel, so that it cannot crack. So it's most membrane tank, as I told you, is mostly used on gas refrigerated ships. So the tank shell and the secondary barrier are built-in profiles formed as a member. This renders the material thickness small and no more than 10 mm thick. So maximum thickness is 10 mm of this tank. You can see it's so thin, it's 1 centimeter. So the membrane thickness is normally 0.5 to 1.2 mm. So 1 centimeter is including the shell and the secondary barrier both. And the membrane thickness is normally of 0.5 to 1. There is insulation in between these two layers and the hull also. Just between secondary membrane and the hull, we have to put insulation that we will see. The insulation is often perlite. Perlite is like plywood boxes or kind of ply that we will see, placed outside each other like building blocks, or polyurethane. So and polyurethane is gradually spread in this space outside the secondary hull in the insulation as the tank is built up. So you have a very good insulation, because we need insulation because it's for refrigerated ships. So membrane and independent membrane or semi-membrane tank is used for independent ships, refrigerated ships. So the hull, you can see that membrane takes up that all the membrane tank takes up all the thermal expansion because of the strong hull, strong metal, and whatever pressure is, extra pressure is there in the tank, more than 0.25 bars, then that's why we need a secondary barrier. We can utilize the hull as a secondary barrier also for cargo temperature down to minus 55 degrees centigrade. But we must utilize low temperature steel in the hull around the cargo tank. So if cargo is more negative than minus 55, then we can also use hull as secondary barrier, but the hull should be again made of this steel requirement, so that it can take the expansion ratio and does not cause fracture. Then the ballast tanks or cofferdams form the hull structure around the cargo tank. As we saw in that picture, the blue parts in the tanks were ballast tanks, like you have on other ships, topside tanks and DB tanks. Then if the cargo is more cooler than minus 55 degrees centigrade, there has to be an insulation after the secondary barrier. So there are different types of designs. It's like a moss. You have a tomb or a mosque or something, like a spherical tank. So we have two designs of membrane tanks. One is done by French Gas Transport, and the other is the moss transport. So we'll see. French Gas Transport patent utilizes two identical membranes. Same membranes are there for the initial first membrane and outer membrane, that is the primary barrier and the secondary barrier. And each is with in 36% nickel steel or inverse steel, depending on the requirement. And the insulation is of perlite, which is filled with plywood boxes. Then Also, we have TechniGas, which is the second type of membrane tank system. So TechniGas is using stainless steel as the main membrane and veneer metal in the secondary membrane. So the main, these are the question asked, the type of tanks, explain or explain the membrane tank or explain the type of tanks for LNG ship or refrigerated ships. So you can write this. So the main membrane is welded together of small plates by a special shaping so that the tank tolerates expansion. The plate thickness is about 1.1 to 2 mm. So main membrane is welded to the secondary membrane. And the first tanks from TechniGas utilize veneer plates. So initially they were utilizing only veneer plates as secondary barrier and balsa as insulation. The balsa wood, you know, is a very good insulating wood. Also, they have polyester coated aluminum foil is now utilized as a secondary barrier and polyurethane foam for insulation. So polyurethane foam is a very good insulator. Initially, you can just even spray or something. These tank types are utilized on large LNG and LPG tankers. So you can have it on LPG or LNG for refrigerated systems. So this is a typical diagram. If you can draw, it's easy diagram to draw in the exam for membrane tank. So this is the tank where you can put liquid. This is the primary membrane that made up of invar or nickel steel. Then you have the secondary barrier. In between these also we have insulation, but this is very small space as we saw. So we have a ship side or hull, and in between this also you have perlite or polyurethane foam insulation. So you can for cargos more negative than minus 55 degrees centigrade also, we can load this in this tank. Then you have a semi-membrane tanks. These are used for LPG tankers. Semi-membrane tanks are built up with an inner tank, insulation, membrane, and insulation against the hull. So same like that, you have insulation between the membranes and insulation against the hull also. It is the membrane that takes up the thermal expansion. So of course the membrane has to take up the thermal expansion, and the tanks are built of aluminium ferro-nickel steel with 36% nickel or built of stainless steel. So it can be made of these materials. And the insulation is a perlite or polyurethane foam or polystyrene. The hull absorbs all the dynamic loads from the cargo tank when the tank is loaded. Normal excess pressure for 2.25 bar is, and there is a demand for secondary barrier. So again, same, if you are loading cargo with more than 0.25 bar, then you need a secondary barrier. So most of the things are same, but it's just that sometimes you have a secondary barrier or no, or it's a thin membrane, and it is called semi-membrane. And then let's see, you also have that you can use the hull as a secondary barrier again for semi-membrane also. If you have cargo more negative than or down to minus 55 degrees centigrade, but you should, again, the hull should be made up of good steel as per required, the alloy, invar or nickel, and you have to place insulation in between them. And if you want to load cargo which is colder than 55 degrees centigrade, then you need to have secondary barrier. You cannot use the hull as a secondary barrier. So semi-membrane has only one membrane and the hull is a secondary barrier when a cargo is above, that is, if it is 50 degrees centigrade or 55, we can load semi-membrane and hull as this thing. But if it is minus 60 or minus 140 for LNG, then we have to have a secondary barrier. So this tank type was designated for mostly LPG transportation for refrigerated ships, and but generally semi-membrane tanks are not used on LPG ships also. Sometimes on large LPGs they are using. Then next, this is a semi-membrane tank, again almost same construction. Then we have independent tanks. Independent tanks are separated, no connection to the hull, so stresses are contained within, and it's like a cradle, you can say. The tank is like, it's first, initially it's a hold, and it's like an empty hold of a bulk carrier, empty box, and the tank is put into that on the wooden blocks or chocks, like the ship is going in the dry dock, same way. The tanks are put like that. So the tank weight is transferred to the cradles or the support points, that is the chocks or wooden blocks. The cargo tanks are built with support to prevent the tank from slipping forward or astern. So on the side, suppose this is the tank. So this is a MOS tank. So on the side there will be a, this is called a skirt, which is welded to the hull, and this way the tank will be multiple supported for side movements. Then the division distinguishes between the pressure the tank must tolerate and the demands for secondary barrier. Independent tank type A has the weakest strength. So different types of tanks we have, type A, type B, and type C. And type A has the weakest strength, type B more, and type C has the greatest strength. So you have inner barrier, primary barrier, secondary barrier. And the space between the primary and secondary barrier should be able to hold the pressure also, because it's not connected to the hull. So all the stresses it should be able to hold, even your insulation. So independent type A has the weakest strength, and there are demands for secondary barrier. Then you have independent type B, which has a greater strength than A, and demands a partial barrier only. Then secondary barrier, partial secondary barrier, and independent type C is a pressure tank. So there's no secondary barrier required, but the metal which is required to build is very thick. So pressure vessels, we have seen only one tank till now, independent type C. And others, membrane, semi-membrane, independent type A, all can be used for refrigerated, type B for semi-refrigerated. Then independent type A in detail. So again, as we saw, your ice cube tray is a prismatic shape. So with that, you can remember that prismatic is for refrigerated ships. So type A, we are using for independent type A for refrigerated ships, which is of 3.5% nickel steel or coal manganese steel or aluminium. So material is recognized standard steel quality, approved by the class companies, this type of cargo tank is utilized for carrying LNG, LPG and ammonia. But generally, we will carry LNG also, we can carry, or some refrigerated LPG and ammonium also, ammonia. So tanks are for excess pressure less than 0.7 bar. So pressure should not be more than 0.7 bar because Type A is not built very strong. Mainly it's for refrigerated vessels. So pressure can be less than 0.7 bar. And normal operating pressure, like maximum 0.7 bar, but normally less than 0.25 bars excess of the atmospheric pressure. And the cargo tanks are mounted on building blocks, so the tank can expand freely. And on the top of the tanks in the ship side or under the deck, brackets are welded to prevent the tank from floating up. That's what we see, the skirt or brackets connected to the hull and support the support. Then the independent tank type B, again it's a prismatic, but it can be spherical also, or membrane tank. So these tanks are for model tested and better than type A, more stronger, and used for big LPG ships or medium sized tankers. The pressure rating is not much mentioned here. Can just write that it's more stronger than type A, because you have to very less time, so this is enough points to write in the exam. Then prismatic tanks are produced in aluminium or 3% nickel in stiff plate. The tanks rest on the reinforced plywood supports for pre-expansion. So in type A we were using wooden blocks for support. Here we are using plywood support for the type B, and tanks provided with centerline bulkhead to reduce the free liquid surface, because we can also use for pressure liquids, so we need a centerline bulkheads. And the tanks are insulated again with polyurethane or perlite. Submerged pumps or deep well pumps are used for discharging on most of the gas ships. Then you can there is a special design for type B tanks, which is called spherical shape, made by Moss Rosenberg, and it is called Moss tanks, and it's produced in aluminium or 9% nickel steel. Tanks are supported with cargo tanks at the equator and down to the hull. So you have a skirt at the bottom connected to the hull, and around the tank is there is a waterproof cover on the top, so that membrane tank is not damaged. So we will see that in the figure, at how the Moss tank, this is a Moss tank, and on top there will be a cover to prevent weather exposure. The tanks are equipped with submerged pumps again, and polyurethane is used as a type B insulation, which is sprayed when the tank is built up. Then the other types of insulation are polystyrene plates or perlite or veneer cases. So spherical tanks, insulation is starting from bottom up to the top, all the sides it has to be. So this is what you are saying, that this is the Moss type spherical tank, membrane tank, type B. This is the primary barrier, and then you have the secondary barrier. And on the deck, on the outside, because this is a very thin membrane, it can be damaged easily by the weather. So we have a protective weather cover, waterproof cover on the deck. And this is the insulation of the cargo hold. And here is the skirt, which is welded to the hull for support. And here you have the wooden or polyurethane choke, and this is the ballast tanks. from top to bottom, they are connected, and you have a center line bulkhead for division and also the deep well pumps. Then you have independent tank type C. Independent tank type C are spherical tanks or cylindrical tanks. You can have two shapes, spherical or cylindrical, and they are built with carbon manganese steel. Why? Because as we discussed, type C is for which type of cargo? Pressurized cargo, like you have LPG in your home. In your home, the LPG which is there is a mixture of propane and butane. And it is carried at high pressures, so they need a very thick material, and that is type C, the most strong material and cylindrical shape or spherical shape to move the pressure all around, because pressure, if it is acting at a point, and it will act that if it is a rectangle tank, it will act as a point and it will destroy the tank. So if it is in a cylindrical tank, it will be equally distributed all around. So, and tanks are built of carbon manganese steel, 2.5% nickel steel, or acid proof stainless steel. This type of tank has a large rate of security and therefore does not need secondary barrier. So very good security is there for the tank, and the tank is utilized for fully pressurized gas carriers, as we discussed, because the first metal itself very strong, and because we don't need insulation, so secondary barrier is not required. Also, we can use on semi-pressurized gas carrier, so because pressurized cargo will also be carried there, and it is used on gas carriers, and the tanks are generally from 300 to 2500 meter cube. Pressurized ships are very difficult to build, and very thick material is very expensive. So very generally small ships are there for pressurized carriers. Then the submerged deep well pumps are utilized as discharge pumps, and the tanks are on cradles, what we saw, the blocks. And the cradles are welded to each other. The cradle functions as a support for the tank to expand freely. So if these are also independent pressure tanks, but they are supported, so the tank can expand freely, like you have a cradle for your life raft. And some designs also have the cradles which are connected by steel bands and extend up to the tank, fastened to the cradle. Or you can have anti-float brackets which are welded to the tank to prevent the floating of the tanks. We will see it is these anti-floats are fitted on the top so that if the tank is there is leakage and the tank bottom is filled with cargo, it floats up. So this top blocks will not allow the tank to move more up and float. So tank designed for cargo colder than minus 10 degree centigrade must have insulation. So, but generally because we are carrying pressurized, so it will be at ambient temperature only. But if it is on semi-pressurized and you need tanks, you need to carry cargo colder than minus 10 degree centigrade, then of course we need to have insulation. Normally we are in thermos, in the home we are having insulation which to just keep at normal temperature, anything hot or cold. So this, if the cargo is minus 10 degrees centigrade, very cold, so we need insulation. Then of course insulation can be same polyurethane, polystyrene, anything. And it is sprayed when the tank is built. Thickness has to be more. Depending on the type of pressure and the temperature that the cargo has to carry. And can be up to 200 mm. So this is the type of pressurized type C tank, independent tank. So you can see it's independent, it's not connected to the hull. It's a cylindrical tank. You have a primary barrier and a secondary barrier. Outside is the hold space, and you can, this is the cradle, which is going from here to here, like you have in the life raft, from port to starboard. This is, we also, we have a tank dome for putting the pump and loading line and other lines, venting lines and reliquation condense line, all will be coming here. And here you have the ballast tanks. Ballast tank here we have only in the bottom is showing because this is a side view. So these are the types of tanks and the photographs. You can see that these are MOS type tanks and these are Technigas tanks. So this is MOS type or Technigas tanks, you can see. This is prismatic tanks and MOS type tanks. And then this is gas transport or Technigas membrane tank designs, which we discussed. Then we have this type A tanks we already saw. Then type B tanks, you can have like this MOS type, spherical. This is the diagram which you can do for make for a spherical type, spherical tank of type B type. Or you can have like this also, bilobe or trilobe, three tanks in one, depending on the designs. Then this is a cylindrical type C tank, which is being installed on a ship, you can see. So you can see on full ship is having only two tanks. This is a small ship and very difficult to make this with big tanks. So generally we have very less capacity small ships of this. So these were all the types of tanks and details of this gas transport membrane tanks. This is a primary and secondary membranes. Primary membrane you can see from inside. You can see very nice steel alloy. Negligible contraction coefficient. And this is the insulation we were talking about. Each layer of insulation, you see such a big insulation is there. So we will see this in detail. This is the Technigas design. You can see this structure design for allowing, there is no central line division, so this will help for a little bit for cargo not to move. So corrugation is there, corrugated stainless steel primary tank membrane. Then this is the layers of the insulation. You can see you have sometimes for retains it's okay, but it's required for orals. So corrugated stainless steel membrane, you have the primary primary barrier, then plywood is the secondary barrier, polyurethane foam as layer, then secondary barrier. So between primary and secondary barrier you have plywood and polyurethane foam, and a secondary barrier and the hull you have polyurethane foam, then plywood, then other sticking and anchoring elements or studs, and the covered wall, final wall of insulation. So this is the layers of insulation. You can make like this simple. Then also this is a diagram how in the tank you have these insulations. and fitted. Then you also you have a prismatic tank which is being loaded onto the ship for refrigerated ships. Then you have the MOS type system, MOS tanks, you can see like this. On LNG ships, you always have MOS type LNG tanker, front view, top view, and inside the tank you have like this, membrane tanks. So this is how prismatic tanks, they look from inside. You have the insulation and the tanks, and then the corrugation, center line division, and you have full tank. It's like you can see, like looking like a oil tanker tank. So that's it about the tanks. You also have integral tanks on some ships. That's it.